Good morning, everyone. And Dr. Aviram, thank you for the invitation to Israel. This is my first visit here, and this is truly a beautiful country. So it's been a very pleasure so far. And thank you for your kind generosity. So today I'm going to talk about the electrical impulse propagation in a diabetic heart. So this is my disclosure slide. I'm funded by funds from the Gilead Pharmaceutical Company. This is my talk outline, and I'm going to describe the motivation and background for what I study, some of the methods that I use in my studies, our results, and summarize our results. So to start with, the background and motivation for our study is the following. So if you go to the site of Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, they have a statistics that suggests that about 26 million people in the United States suffer from diabetes. And as we all know now that diabetes is a significant cause of cardiovascular disease, epidemiological studies also suggest that the risk of sudden cardiac death is much higher in diabetic patients. Now, the underlying mechanisms, however, are not very clear, and this is where my research interests currently lie. And what I'm focusing on is how is the cardiac ventricular electrophysiology altered in diabetes, and how this can lead to arrhythmias, which is a major cause of sudden cardiac death. So a number of previous studies in basic science, basically in cardiac electrophysiology, have used rodent models of diabetes, being rat and mouse. Now, what they have shown consistently, and these are pioneering studies done by Professor Yakin Shimoni, who trained in Israel and who's now based in Calgary. So what he has shown consistently is that in diabetic rats, the cardiac action potential duration is prolonged. So on the left-hand side of the panel, what you're seeing is a ventricular action potential from a rat ventricular myocyte. And you can see that the action potential duration is significantly prolonged in diabetes. Now, in recent years, Dr. Shimoni's group has also suggested that although in diabetic rats, the electrical impulse propagation is not different at normal extracellular potassium levels, if you challenge these hearts with high extracellular potassium, the activation time or the impulse propagation becomes slower in diabetic hearts, and the mechanisms for this are not known. Now, one of the things that was of interest to me when I started my work in diabetes was the choice of species. Now, because I am interested in studying the cardiac ventricular action potential, the first thing that comes to mind is the difference between the action potentials in the rat and humans. So if you look at the right-hand side, you can see that a ventricular action potential in a rat or a mouse ventricular cell is triangular and of a very short duration. And the main ionic current that is responsible for this very short action potential duration is a potassium channel called transient outward current, or ITO. In contrast, if you look at higher mammals such as dogs, rabbits, and including humans, this is a representative ventricular action potential in these three species. It's more spike and dome, not a triangular shape. It's much longer. And the main ionic currents responsible for repolarization is not the transient outward current, but a set of currents called the delayed rectifier potassium currents, primarily IKR and IKS. And these currents play little or no role in the rat or mouse ventricular action potential. So I decided to start my study with a rabbit model of diabetes because these are the currents that really are of interest. And you can also study ventricular fibrillation, which is again another area of interest for me, much more easily in higher mammalian models. Now, it's not as if other people have not investigated altered cardiac electrophysiology in rabbits and dogs. And in recent years, a couple of groups have done extensive studies in these species. They have studied cardiac repolarization or the action potential, how it is changed in diabetes. And they've come up with very controversial results. So a group in Montreal Heart Institute studied the action potential duration in diabetic rabbits. And they found that the action potential duration was quite prolonged. And they attributed it to a downregulation in the rapid delayed rectifier potassium current. In contrast, a group led by Professor Andras Varo in Hungary found little or no prolongation of APD in diabetic rabbits, and they did not find a downregulation of IKR. And in fact, they found that a different delayed rectifier, the IKS current, was downregulated. And both of these groups, they studied these action potentials in single cells, and they did not really study if cardiac propagation was altered. So this was with the background that I started my studies in diabetic rabbits. Now, this was the objective, and some of the methods that I utilized in my studies include optical imaging of isolated hearts, patch clamp in single cells, molecular biology, and math modeling. And I'll just briefly touch upon each of these methods to just give you a brief glimpse of what each of these techniques can do. So in optical mapping of heart, you take an isolated heart, put it in a Langendorf apparatus, and you keep it alive for about 3 to 4 hours. And what you can do is you can perfuse the heart with a voltage-sensitive dye, shine a green light laser on it, and when the electrical activity occurs in the heart, you can capture it by emission with a red filter with a CCD camera. So let me show you an example of how optical mapping works. And this is in a rabbit heart. What you're looking at is the anterior side of a rabbit ventricular myocardium. So this is the left ventricle, this is the right ventricle. And this is an optical imaging movie of normal electrical excitation in the rabbit heart, intrinsic. I'm not pacing the heart. This is just sinus rhythm in the rabbit ventricle. And this is what you will see. Let's hope the movie plays. Yeah. So what you're seeing is basically the impulse, two breakthroughs, first in the right ventricle, one in the left ventricle, and then you can see that the impulse propagation follows in the diabetic ventricle. So this is what optical imaging allows you to do. So if now you take one point, any point in this ventricle, you can actually see an optical action potential. And this allows you to calculate the duration or action potential duration by optical mapping. Not only that, you can also now construct what is called as an activation map. So basically, if you play this movie again, you can see that the activation occurs first in the right ventricle. This is indicated by the red dot here, red color here. And you can now plot at different times how the activation proceeds from the right ventricle and then the left ventricle. And you can draw what are known as isochron lines. These are about 5 milliseconds apart. And thereby, you can then calculate how fast or slow your impulse propagation is. So optical mapping allows us not only APD, or action potential duration, but also an assessment of the conduction or impulse propagation in the heart. We also used patch clamp to study the ionic properties of different currents in single cells. And this is just a typical patch clamp setup. This is an inverted microscope, and you can put a cardiac cell in this, poke it with an electrode, and using voltage clamp techniques, you can study different ionic currents of your interest. So potassium channels, calcium channels, or sodium channels. We also use standard molecular biology techniques and quantified mRNA protein levels and fibrosis, as I will show you in later slides. And finally, my background is electrical engineering. So I use computer modeling also to interpret my experimental recordings. And I put it all together and I solve for simple reaction diffusion equations to understand, you know, does my experimental data from the cell to the heart level, does it all make sense? So let's look at the results real quick. So we used a model of diabetic rabbits, which was induced via Alloxan. And we kept the rabbit diabetic up for about 150 days or about 5 months. And as you can see that the level of glucose on the day of the experiment in diabetic rabbits was much higher compared to controls. Now, just to summarize quickly, and I'll show you some of the actual results as well. In our hands, we did not find that any of the rabbits were dying suddenly, in contrast to the group from Montreal who reported sudden cardiac deaths. But in our hands, we did not find all the rabbits were perfectly fine. What we did see was that there was no change in the action potential duration in these diabetic rabbits, and the cardiac impulse propagation was slower. So just a quantification of the data. Now, this is a kind of a busy slide, but I'll walk through you very slowly. So on the left-hand side, what we are showing is the action potential duration. This is action potential duration in control hearts and diabetic hearts. And what you can see is at baseline, that is at normal levels of potassium, there is no difference in the action potential duration. We also stress the hearts to high levels of potassium, low levels and high levels of potassium, hypo and hyperkalemia. And you can still see that the action potential duration was not different between control and diabetic hearts. Now, there was a reason to do this test with hypokalemia and hyperkalemia. This was because there is controversy, as I told you earlier, about whether IKR is upregulated is downregulated in the diabetic heart or not. And this current is very sensitive to changes in extracellular potassium. So we figured that if we stress the heart and if this current were indeed downregulated, you would see action potential duration differences in either of these conditions, even if we did not see it here. But in our hands, in this experimental model, we do not see in any of these conditions any changes in the action potential duration. Now, if you look at the data for the conduction velocity, which quantifies how fast your impulse is propagating, you can see that the diabetic heart, the conduction velocity is about 13% slower in the diabetic heart compared to controls. And when you stress it with hypokalemia, this result holds, is again 17% slower. Now, if you stress it with very high levels of potassium, about 12 millimolars, you see that it really gets slower. Now, the difference is about 33%. So the slower conduction velocity is exacerbated in hyperkalemic conditions. Now, just to show you an example of the activation patterns, remember we saw the activation patterns earlier, and you can see that the activation pattern, this is the activation pattern in a control rabbit ventricle, and this is the site of the pacing. Now, these hearts were all paced at 250 milliseconds basic cycle length, and you can see that the propagation is faster in the control hearts compared to the diabetic hearts. It takes much longer for the impulse to propagate in a diabetic heart. And in a lot of times, you also see these 2:1 propagation patterns where you can see these conduction blocks occurring in a diabetic heart. So you rarely see these in control hearts. Now, the next question was, what is the ionic basis of this slow conduction? And we obviously looked at the first current or the major current that is responsible for the excitation of the action potential and its propagation, and that is the sodium current. And you can quantify the sodium current with patch clamp techniques, and you can look at different things. So this is, for example, a recording of the sodium current in control cells versus diabetic cells. On the y-axis is current in nanoamperes, x-axis is milliseconds, and you can see that the amplitude of the sodium current is reduced in diabetic ventricular myocytes. Now, if you quantify the current density, you can see again that the sodium current density is about 35% smaller in diabetic ventricular cells compared to controls. And there are other properties that can contribute to slower propagation in the diabetic ventricle, but we really did not see any differences in the steady state inactivation or the recovery from inactivation between control and diabetic cells. Now, we looked at the molecular biology and we did not find any differences in NAV1.5, which is the main molecular correlate of the sodium channel, either at the mRNA level or at the protein level. There tends to be a reduction in the protein level, but it's not statistically different. The other thing that could contribute to a slower propagation in the diabetic heart is that cells are connected via gap junctions, and we looked at the main gap junction in the ventricle, which is connection 43, and we do not find any difference in the mRNA or the protein levels of connection 43 as well. Now, another thing that could contribute to a slower propagation in the diabetic ventricle could be fibrosis. So we stained for fibrosis in these hearts, and as you can see, by picroserious red, we have stained for fibrosis and quantified the levels, and they really are not different between control and diabetic hearts. Now, to put it all together, okay, we see these differences in single cells. Do these differences really explain the slower propagation that we are seeing in the whole heart? So for this purpose, we utilized computer simulations. And in panel A, you can see our setup. Now, this is a simple 2D sheet that we use. And you can use model ionic cells or ventricular cells using ionic models, in this case developed by Professor Yoram Rudy, who was a student of Technion, incidentally. So you can actually downregulate the sodium current and see, if you give a stimulus, how does this impulse propagate? And let's focus on this panel C directly for time purposes. And what you can see is on the x-axis are different manipulations that we did in the computer model. That is, in the case, we reduced the sodium current by about 30%, which is what we find experimentally. And by doing this, you can actually see that the reduction in the conduction velocity is about 10 to 12% in both hypokalemia and normokalemia. And this slower conduction velocity becomes much slower in high potassium or hyperkalemia, just as we saw in experiments. So a reduction in sodium current seems to explain our optical mapping results of slower propagation. In contrast, we also changed the coupling coefficient, which represents gap junctions, or the sodium potassium pump, but both of these changes could not explain our results of slower impulse propagation in the diabetic heart. So in summary, repolarization is not altered in our hands in this diabetic rabbit model, but the impulse propagation is definitely slower, and a reduced density of the sodium current seems to be the key underlying ionic mechanism of this slow impulse propagation. Now, these findings may have implications for arrhythmogenesis, and we have not explored that in detail yet. Now, where do we go from here? So this was very interesting, but now I think we are very excited in that we are working on a different model of diabetes. This is the high-fat diet-induced diabetes model. And you can see we've just finished these studies last week. And these rabbits gain weight over a period of about 17 to 18 weeks, and they're also hypoglycemic. But I don't have any results to present today because we've literally finished these experiments last Friday. But we are very excited to see what this brings us. I would like to thank a number of people who have contributed to this project. I would like to thank my mentor, Dr. Khalife. Thank you for your support. David Pinsky, I can't see David anywhere, but thank you for providing support for the high-fat diet experiments. A number of colleagues who have really done a lot of the experiments and work, and all the different funding agencies. Thank you for your attention.